think there is some network issue on madam's side.
You can just start the topic and the intro, and I can start then. Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sure, sir. I will start. Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Nanda Rupnar, Faculty of IT Department of Kelkar Education Trust, VG Vazi College of Arts, Science and Commerce, and host of today's webinar. Respected Principal, Dr. B.B. Sharma, sir, Vice Principal, Degree College, Dr. Preeta Nilesh, madam, Vice Principal of Junior College, C.A. Vidyadhar Joshi, Head of IT Department, Ms. Purnima Bhangale, Deans of Art, Commerce, and Science faculties, my dear colleagues and participants. I welcome you all on behalf of IT Department from KITS VG Vazi College on today's webinar. As we all know, in the thirst of being self-dependent, we humans have developed a lot of dependencies such as internet, websites, Internet of Things, various new technologies and modern tools. Leading life in such a complex web of dependencies has posed a great risk of cyber attacks, cyber frauds, banking fraud, and many more. To combat such risk and manage these risk-prone situations has become a need of an hour. So to guide us on such one of the topic like digital payment safety, we are privileged to have with us our today's guest speaker, Advocate Mr. Vicky Shah. Sir, I welcome you for today's webinar. Advocate Vicky Shah is a renowned practicing lawyer in Bombay High Court. Sir has started his career as a trainer to law enforcement agencies, police of many agencies in India for cybercrime investigation techniques in October 2004. Sir has been an advocate, author, trainer, speaker from European Center for Privacy and Cybersecurity, Maastricht University, Netherlands. And he is one of the founder, member, and co-chair of International Association of Privacy Professionals. Sir is associated and works with various government.
Thanks to Vandana ma'am for her efforts for this session. It was being planned in February, and then I was unwell with COVID, and because of that, it got delayed by a month. Thank you all for joining this program today. The idea is that, because of the lockdown, we have seen exponential growth in the digital payment adaptation and acceptance by people. Everybody today uses this. First, it was demonetization in 2016, and now with the lockdown last year, we just completed a 1 year today. Today being the first day of the lockdown when it was announced last year. So in the last year or so, we have seen the adaptation of digital payments has increased. Vis-a-vis the frauds which are happening on this platform also have increased. There have been numerous cases where people have shared their OTP, UPI IDs, passwords, PINs, so debit card fraud, net banking fraud, KYC fraud, and the list goes on. So I'm going to touch upon all those aspects. First, before even we know, we need to understand the digital payment modes which are available and existing in India today. So when we understand what happens in a on an internet in a minute, there are numerous logins, numerous messages, numerous videos being created. This video, this stream also is being broadcasted live online. Then we have apps being downloaded. There are Instagram posts which are happening, Twitter messages being sent. So net connectivity, the adaptability, the acceptability, the usage has increased in this last 1 year, more in particular because people had more time to spend on it, and with nothing to do, no work pressure, nothing, free time, leisure time. So most of them were online, and with that we have various threats that can be seen when we talk about online payment, online systems. If we see the current trends and current threats that are being faced by us, so we see a lot of instances of malware, ransomware, where if people are using pirated software, then their computers get compromised. They do not get updated patches. All the files become unreadable. Then the person sends an email that if you don't pay so much bitcoins, we will not send you decryption key, and you will not be able to access your data. Then fishing and social engineering, this will be there. This has been existing from the time ancient times, and it will continue to do grow. The advantage or the disadvantage here is these fishing and the social engineering has been increase the variations have changed. There are different ways in which it is done. The few of them are done physically, few of them are done online. Fraudulent wallet applications, we have also seen cases where there are fake applications of banks that are created, fake wallet apps that are created, and then the fraud is committed. Man in the middle, basically somebody tries to intercept communication from party A and party B and miscommunicate both the parties and try to gather the information which is crucial, and then whenever there is a payment aspect involved, then the account is changed or the payment is diverted to some other account. NFC is near frequency code based attack. So if you have this Wi-Fi enabled debit cards, credit cards, by default there is no OTP, the PIN required for a amount of up to 2,000 rupees. So they try to use that particular device and then swipe the amount. There is a special RFID purse which you can purchase, or the best simple solution is you have an aluminium foil. You can put your cards in the aluminium foil that prevents the NFC card reader to read the card details. Then there are platform-based threats which are more at the network provider level or the payment application provider level. There are crimes as a service which are being offered of late. There are people who impersonate organizations, misrepresent somebody else's identity or name, and then try to commit fraud. There are malicious insiders which are responsible for this. Two-factor authentication is in place since 2009 in India, but still people are not that aware or educated to not to share their OTP, and then they fall victims to these frauds. There are hardware issues, software issues, vulnerabilities. And when we see about future, we see mobile malware, which could be possibly, so currently the systems are being targeted, but in future we may see the mobile platforms being targeted. Cyber warfare activities can be then, you know, extended. Emerging tech platforms and misuse. So we see UIDAI platforms, a lot of things, a lot of innovative frauds on happening on that. Even if you do Google and do find Play Store, you'll find various several applications which are not authorized or correct app for Aadhaar or your UIDAI, but they still capture all the information. Unfortunately, there is no body to regulate or block such applications without the number of proper requested number of block or reporting request. So that is again going to be there. IoT attacks, so Internet of Things, thanks to Alexa and Google, okay Google, you know, most of the things are being happening online. You use the convenience is there, but at the same time people try to misuse. And also currently there is no voice authentication or voice biometrics which is in place, because even if it's your phone or my phone, somebody being nearby, and if he just says hey Siri, okay Siri, or okay Google, the phone gets activated. So that's the kind of threat which we see. Social media attacks are going to continue. Advanced technology attacks, cryptocurrency, again there is a regulation is in place. We don't know when it will come and be enacted, but the legislation is about to be drafted. And the digital payment infrastructure complexity, so the way the payments are being available today and offered, that gives the advantage to both fraudster as well as users. So the objective of digital payments is basically convenience and ease. It is more secure compared to making transactions involved with cash, because cash, the notes can be soiled, the currency can be fake. Digital transactions are easy. You can do it at the click of a button. You don't require, but the only thing is you need to be alert, cautious before you do so. Then there are development and modernization. So if you see today, practically everything is available online, like right from your driving license permit to learning license to RC book to a transfer of ownership of the vehicles to domicile certificate, your change of name, whatever applications you want, everything is happening online. Slowly we see the legal system also, thanks to lockdown, it made that compulsion for them also to be online on VC. So we have now video conferencing hearings as well. Online court fees are being paid. So as and when we grow, we will see more and more adoption of digital payments, and everything will be online. That also helps in saving the overheads of the cost involved for making the cache available to the remote locations. So a lot of things are getting improved. It also helps to reduce corruptions at a level. Overall, it boosts the rural economy and enables better development and for us. Component and stakeholders, these are the agencies who are involved. So basically, these are the players from where the police officers get their response for investigation, applications, websites, payment mechanism, offline, online, interface, major stakeholders, application users, payment brokerage, payment service providers, basically are also known as PSPs or banks. E-wallet companies, payment gateways, payment aggregators. So the difference between the payment gateway and the payment aggregator is payment gateway does real-time settlement. And payment aggregator takes the payment on behalf of some merchant and then it makes the payment to the merchant. So it doesn't do real-time settlement. It does the transaction settlement after a day or so, depending on the agreement between the parties. Because practically, it is not possible to have agreement and tie up with all the banks, with all agencies. So there are payment gateways and payment aggregators like you have Razorpay, Instamojo, BillDesk, CC Avenue. They try to have this mechanism where they take the payment on behalf of the merchant and the buyer, and then they settle it between them after a day or two. Service providers, telecom, especially the mobile. So we have three major players now, BSNL, Airtel, Jio, and Vodafone Idea. Earlier, at one point in time, we had some 10, 11 different operators, but now everything is consolidated. So we have four major players. ISPs are the ones who provide internet services. Mobile applications. So unfortunately, for everything, you require an application, and every bank wants their own application to be used. So that is another challenge, because how many applications will one download today if you have to make a payment? So with this, there was UPI, which got introduce. UPI is basically unified payment interface. It allows you to make payment at real time between a person or a merchant or a service, and you don't have to remember the long account digit or 12 14 digit account number or the IFSC code. You just have to have the virtual payment address, which is VPA, and you can make the payment. So and the idea is that if you have 10 accounts in 10 different banks, you don't require to have 10 mobile applications. One application will be sufficient to use all the 10 accounts. So that it's a good facility, but again, that itself is the one which gets exploited. So if we see the digital payment ecosystem in our country, we have a regulator, which is the RBI. They are governing and having the regulatory framework for digital payment and transaction processing. In fact, the latest one was released just 2 weeks back, I think on 15th of March, about digital payments. They came with a new circular. RBI came with a new circular. Customers today have options of making payments through either by bank cards, which includes your debit, credit, prepaid, wallet, forex, mobile wallets, mobile banking, internet banking, point of sale, which is your device on which we swipe the card, micro ATMs. This was very popular when demonetization was there. The local kirana shop was acting as a bank where you could deposit the money, you could withdraw the money up to 2000 rupees and above. Bank prepaid cards, these are the simple, like a prepaid mobile phone. It's a prepaid bank card which has a limit of say 5,000, 10,000. If you do a proper KYC, you can even get up to 1 lakh rupee. So this amount, once it gets zero, then again you can refill it and reuse it. So the exposure and the risk is only of the amount which is there in the card. Payment banks, the difference between the payment bank and payment wallets are you cannot withdraw money from the wallet. From the payment banks, you can do the purchasing of this services and goods, and you also get interest. You can put money in the FD, fixed deposit. So earlier, Paytm started as a wallet, but now it's a payment bank, so it is no more a wallet. Then retail banking is your individual saving accounts, where you open your account, save your money, and do all the banking related activities. Corporate banking is generally for institutions, corporates, employer, where they make payments from salary payments, business payments, and expenses. And financial service providers are certain agencies which could either be into loan or lending business. So there are various other ways in which they can be part of the system. So acquiring and issuing, these are the two important concepts which one should know, because whenever you do a transaction, say for example, you want to purchase, you go on a two-wheeler to fuel a petrol. So your bank card, which you have, suppose I am a customer of, say, SBI bank, then SBI becomes my issuing bank because that is the bank from which I was issued the credit, debit card or credit card. Then there is a payment scheme, which is also known as card brand. It could be RuPay, Visa, NPCI. NPCI has a RuPay brand in India. Then you have MasterCard, Visa, Discover, JCB, China UnionPay. So these are the card brands, American Express and all. Merchant is the one where you are going to use your card for making any payment, shopping. The payment processor is basically a device which is linked to the bank account of that merchant. So whenever you swipe a card, your transaction will get approved by your bank and settled to the other side within 35 seconds to 40 seconds, and the entire transaction happens. But the interesting thing to see here is that the entire sequence of transaction happens in 35 seconds, but it goes to six stages. So six people have the same transaction reference number, which can be trailed out and traced out. So online payments can always be traced from the source to the destination. Unlike your physical cash, where you don't know what currency you had and who all had been using it. When we talk about India, the digital payment methods in India, there is AEPS, which is Aadhaar enabled payment system, banking cards, which includes your debit credit. We'll see each one in detail. So AEPS basically is Aadhaar enabled payment system. It currently is being offered by 118 banks. It works when Aadhaar is linked with the bank account. Now, suppose if you have four or five accounts, the whichever account was last seeded with the Aadhaar number, that becomes your active account. In case of multiple accounts, the last account becomes the active account. The services what you is available to users. You can check balances, you can withdraw cash, you can deposit cash, you can do Aadhaar to Aadhaar fund transfer, you can do customer to business and customer to government transactions. It's an assisted model because you require a bank representative or somebody to verify your biometric authentication. Without that, this cannot be done. Either through micro ATM, which has an inbuilt biometric reader, or Aadhaar number OTP based authentication. Because of the Supreme Court judgment, the Aadhaar biometrics have now been not been made mandatory. So you also can authorize through OTP. Bank name, Aadhaar holder physically is required to do this. It cannot be done without the person being present. Banking cards, there are some 751 banks which issue this. It includes all your debit, credit, cash, travel, and other cards. Since 2009, India has been adopting two-factor authentication, which is now being adopted by the Western countries. So in Europe and in US, this has been now made mandated since 2019, but we were using it since 2009, almost 10 years after we started to adopt this. KYC is mandatory for issuance of card because you need to know who is the customer, if the customer documents are fake, and if the bank is not responsible, if able to locate the customer, and if there is some fraud, then the bank is liable to pay the damages to the person who is affected. But this has to be fought legally in the court. Post-terminal PIN is mandatory for transactions above rupees 2000. Now this has been revised to 5000. Online payment gateway, two-factor password is mandatory in India. If there is a foreign website where you use your Indian card, it may skip the two-factor password. And if there is some unauthorized transaction, then the entire money can be reversed to you back because two-factor is compulsory in India. And abroad transactions, if something goes wrong, you can always dispute the transaction. It can be used on point of sale, ATM, micro ATM shops, wallets, online transactions, e-commerce websites. Transaction limits depends on the bank. Nowadays, with the RBI's new mandate, each of the customer can set up their own transaction limit in through their mobile app. Whether you want 5,000 per day per transaction or 50,000 or 5 lakh per day per transaction. So that is the good facility which is available to users. So your mobile phone becomes very, very important. I generally suggest people to have this mobile phone, which is used for banking, to be separate, and for other purposes separate, like your Facebook and your other stuff. Don't have everything of WhatsApp and Facebook and the same mobile number for bank account. It becomes too much of saturated, because if the mobile number, something happens to that, everything is for a toss. So always try to have a mobile number separate for your banking and a separate for communication, so that it is not same. Users can set the limits on their own. Then we have banks prepaid card, which are also available with the leading banks. Full KYC is required, compulsory wallet card, prepaid card. So wallet, nowadays people don't prefer to swipe card. They prefer to scan a QR code, which it comes under the Bharat QR regulations by NPCI and RBI, where people can just scan and pay with any mode, any application, any card, any wallet, any UPI app, any net banking app. MPIN PIN is very, very important for this. There is a loading on money from RBI for this. Smartphones with internet is required for these transactions to complete. You have various services on prepaid card, which is balance, transaction history, add money, accept money, pay money, another wallet with same provider, merchant, QR code, cash. You can even withdraw cash depending on if it is a foreign travel card or if it is a card which has a full KYC limit, then you can even withdraw the cash from these cards. Without KYC, you only get a limit of 10,000 or 5,000. I think there is a question, so I'll just see what kind of question is it. If there is some question in this regards. Okay, no, not yet. Fine, so sorry, continue. So internet banking is available through three modes in India. We have National Electronic Fund Transfer, which is NEFT. It can be done through mobile banking, net banking, or offline in the branch. A minimum 1 rupee up to 99 lakhs can be done at a time. RTGS is only for 2 lakhs and above, 2 lakhs, 5 lakhs in that range. It cannot be done for amount less than 2 lakhs. Electronic clearing system is your ECS, which is for your auto pay of loans, utility bills, insurance premiums, etc. Immediate payment system service is your IMPS, which is 24/7. The UPI is based on IMPS. It is an advanced IMPS. So the backbone of UPI is IMPS. It does instant money transfer through internet and mobile. Just type the UPA, verify the account, type the UPI pin, and the amount goes. So each bank has its own limit. Some banks allows 5,000 per day, 20,000 per day, 25,000, 1 lakh rupees. So depending on your bank, this limits will be there. Micro ATMs basically are devices which were used by business correspondents to deliver basic banking services. This could be as low as suppose you are in a remote tier 2 city, there is no ATM facility. If the ATM has to reach and reload the machine, the cost and overheads would be much higher. So what a bank would rather do is implement a micro ATM at a kirana or a general store. Tell them that, you know, we will pay you X percent of commission on the basis of transaction which you allow us to do. You can accept money, deposit in the account, and you can withdraw the money and give it to the users so they can use it. This was very, very popular during demonetization. Mobile payments, all PSP, that is the banks or payment service providers, have their own app. They can share their system development kit or application programming interface API with fintech companies. Banks can have multiple apps or integrate all features within an app. Separate app for smartphone depending upon technology, Google Play Store, iOS, Windows. Mobile banking generally for smartphones and tablets. I would always suggest and recommend you, whatever bank you are having your bank account with, use that particular banking app to do transactions, because if there is something wrong or there is some dispute, you will get remedy faster from your own bank rather than cross-banking applications or transactions, because that becomes difficult for coordination and paperwork and legal trail and other things. So always use the account in which you have a bank account, that app. People always ask me whether Google Pay is safe or Paytm is safe or UPI is safe. So everything is safe. But Google Pay, my personal experience is that I have seen a lot of failed transactions, even for genuine authorized payment mechanism, and the same payment have already been made in the past. Then also I get failed transactions, or in future if you do transactions it gets through. But Google Pay also, there was a circular by RBI of not saying that Google Pay is a private entity. You have to contact the bank for the consent dispute if any it arises. It usually takes around 7 to 15 days for resolution. So again, that is another reason why people don't prefer it. But it's very convenient. People can just put mobile number and make a payment. Ultimately, in the background, it is UPI architecture. Then there are some 40 plus mobile wallet companies which allow you to have the money paid to them. They give you wallet money in the wallet, and that amount from the wallet can be used to do transactions. So there is a zero KYC wallet, customer wallet, merchant wallet, and so on and so forth. We can see various types of mobile wallets. Open wallet allows a user to buy goods and services, withdraw cash at ATMs or banks. A closed wallet is basically only between the customer and the company, like your Shoppers Stop and Lifestyle. You can't use Shoppers Stop and Lifestyle's card anywhere else except Shoppers Stop and Lifestyle. So those become closed wallet. Semi-closed wallet, earlier, you know, you had Paytm, which was that. But now because it become a bank, it is no more a semi-closed wallet. Physical point of sale, when we talk about it, is point of sale, a place where sales are made. Customer is physically required to complete a transactions. You need to have a handheld device with card or biometric reader, Ingenico, Verifone, M-Swipe, MR POS. There are various devices. Paytm has come with their own device nowadays, with which also comes with a sound box. So moment you make a payment, it makes an announcement of payment being received. Merchant bank account is linked with the above account, above devices. Internet connectivity or Wi-Fi is required for the transaction to get established and get settled. Services that are offered are paperwork with bank for merchant account, deposit certain amount, collect devices, configuration and training to operate. For transactions, it could be supported card, resident for biometric, or assisted mode. So basically the point is, there are within the device itself multiple options which could be selected by the vendor, merchant, and the customer. Then there are mobile and virtual POS as well as physical POS. Physical POS is the one which we generally use at the medical shop, petrol pump, and stuff. Mobile POSs are where you want to make payment and somebody asks you to scan the QR code from their phone and make a payment. Virtual is the payment gateways and the virtual, like most of the websites today, if you see, they allow you to make payments online with all modes of payment, with QR, with UPI, with credit, debit, net banking, wallet. So all are integrated in the backend, but they provide various different mechanisms for users to choose. UPI, Unified Payment Interface. It's developed by NPCI. It was launched in 2016, on August 15th, 2016. Global first, we show the world how to do safe and secure banking, and no need for multiple bank applications. People always ask me whether UPI is safe or not. I say that UPI is 100% safe. If the user does not know the terms of send, receive, collect, pay, receive, send, receive, and if because of that they end up giving their UPI pin or OTP or other details, then you can't blame the platform for that. UPI is the most secure system ever which exists so far as we speak, and I've been using it extensively. I've been part of it also, so I know how it works, what are the controls in place to avoid frauds. It is a independent mode of payment. It does not require you to have a particular software of a particular bank. The backend is on Bheem, which is Bharat Interface for Money, set up by NPCI. So most of the banks are allowing you to do transactions. You have Phone Pay, Paytm, Google Pay, Amazon Pay, which are now giving you integrations with third party and Bharat Bill payment system, so that you can make your payments and other details can be shared. The important thing here is that you need to have a mobile number registered with the bank account, then only you can use UPI. If you do not have a mobile number registered with the bank account, you can't use UPI. It works on smartphone and feature phone both. In the case of feature phone, the limit is only 5,000 rupees per transaction and 50,000 per year. Whereas when you have a smartphone, you can do the transactions based on the bank, your bank, which offers you that. To activate this, you need to download UPI app. You need to register through the hardware binding, that is the SMS plus handset. Provide debit card, last 6 digit and OTP. Once you authenticate, then they ask you to create a virtual payment address, which is VPA, which is ideally in the format of username @PSP, that is the bank name. You have to set up the UPI pin, which becomes your second password. So first pin is to open the UPI app. Second pin is to put this password, which is only known to you. And anywhere you do payment or you initiate the payment, the same PIN works. You don't have to change PIN as per the application. You can do balance inquiry. You can send money. You can receive money, that is asking money from other users. There was a bug in the app application developed by the vendor of Bank of Maharashtra, and because of that, they had to face some big issue. The police did a good job. They recovered the entire amount. Most of the target victims were the farmers who were told that under the disguise of Jandan, they'll be getting a bank money in their bank account, and they will have to give the commission to the fraudsters who had ensured that they will help in doing it. SIM swap is another issue where targeted Airtel mobile users earlier. Nowadays, you will see Vodafone users being affected more. Airtel has improved their system. Jio has improved their system. So we don't see SIM swap cases for Airtel and Jio now. But earlier, it was targeted to those customers. Nowadays, we see Vodafone Idea customers being victim of SIM swap. So basically, SIM swap is somebody tries to call you. They ask you your 19-digit IMSI, that is International Mobile Service Identity, which is the 19-digit on the backside of your SIM. Then they try to send a message through their blank SIM and then ask you to type 1 so that your SIM card gets deactivated and the new SIM card gets activated. There are people who fall prey to this under the disguise of activation and KYC. So that is a big thing, a fraud which happens. USSD is unstructured supplementary service data. USSD works without internet. It can be worked on smart feature phone and does not require a smartphone. The SMSs are used to do transactions, and the charges are there accordingly. Transaction limits are 5,000 per day and 50,000 per year. So that is the limitations in the same. When we summarize the various modes of digital payments, so we have banking cards, which is credit debit, stored value prepaid cards, unified payment interface, e-wallets, USSD, other enabled payments, and so on. Defacement of websites, application content modification, unauthorized access to system resources through network or system interface, visiting malicious websites or internet applications may lead to system compromise. Sensitive data may be lost during data transfer or during storage on the system. Malicious program may get installed unknowingly. Sensitive data may be lost during disposal or replacement of the storage media. In critical sensitive application, there may be targeted attack on the systems, attempt to send out sensitive data from the systems. So basically, what we see is, you know, whenever there is a mobile banking fraud or OTP related fraud, we have come across cases where the fraudster tell the user to download a software of either TeamViewer or maybe AnyDesk, and once they download this software, then they try to compromise and take control of the gadget of the victim. Then after, they will initiate the transaction. So tomorrow when it is done, the IP is yours, the mobile phone is yours, the transaction initiation is yours. It becomes difficult for you to prove that you are not the one who has authorized it or you have did it, but the transaction happened because of certain element of fraud in it. So that becomes a challenge to prove. So never download any malicious softwares or any software which is of not required, not used. By default, all these apps take a lot of permissions about sharing data, sharing of photos, accessing the photos, accessing the location. So all this helps, or this this is a gray area which needs to be addressed. Common offenses what we see when we talk about payment frauds are phishing, ransomware, smart city IoT, QR code, device compromise, SIM swap frauds, and job frauds. When we talk about phishing, it is basically a mechanism where social engineering techniques are used to steal customers' personal identity data or financial details. Social engineering schemes wherein you use your spoofed emails purporting from the legitimate business and agencies designed to lead consumers to counterfeit websites. It tricks the recipient into divulging financial data such as username and passwords, the basic for which you require. We have got a very interesting case where one of the user got a SMS from an unknown number. The customer was not vigilant enough to check it. It just clicked on the link. When the link was clicked, the Kotak Mahindra Bank's phishing website was opened. The customer didn't realize it that, you know, the bank website will look different from mobile and different from the browser. So he then entered the information of his username, password, and then the fraudster sent him another message to download the OTP, which was to activate the net banking. Once that was done, the fraudster then purchased certain prepaid vouchers and made the payments to the electricity board and stuff. And the customer, just within a fraction of 10 minutes, he saw his account getting debited by almost 95,000 rupees. So in this case, because the OTP was shared and the access was given by the customer, the bank will not be responsible to pay the customer back, because customer has voluntarily given the information which is supposed to be kept secured and secured by them. So that is what happens at the ground level. Then we have technical subterfuge schemes and also spear phishing schemes, where it is a targeted attack for individuals or business. This was when the PM launched the PM CARES as SBI handle for the corona, for raising the funds. Somebody created a look-alike UPI ID with one letter change in the handle, and then the money also were transferred. It was later on blocked and recovered. But, you know, people also come with innovation and innovative techniques of fraud. Ransomware becomes one of the most widespread and damaging threats that internet user faces. Also, the crypto locker, the first appeared in 2013. Then after, the ransomware has improved and has been sophisticated. In many cases, you don't get the key, even if there are instances where people pay up the ransom, but still they don't get the decryption key to get their data back. So always better to have your data daily backup, so that if something like this happens, you can always have your data which is backed up and start working on it rather than waiting for the data to be restored. QR technology, very, very innovative and a path-breaking technology for payments in the country. You don't even have to remember the name, account, IFSC, just scan, pay, and done. And this itself, the way it provides flexibility, it also is easy for a fraudster to commit fraud, because after scanning the QR code, people don't verify. If you don't verify who the payment recipient is or where the payment is going, there are chances that it may so happen that you have not followed your due diligence in place. Also, QR technology is through mobile, so you don't have to have a separate hardware software for it. You can generate the QR code on the screen. People can scan it and then immediately make payment of it. So it avoids a lot of wastage of papers. You know, everything becomes more convenient with the technology. We've got a case where one of the person had put. So generally, the shopkeepers have the habit of sticking their QR code outside their shop. One fine day, we found one of the areas of suburbs of Mumbai. The fraudster created a fake QR code and printed on the real QR code. So all the payments which were made went to his account and not to the owner's account. And after a few hours, he realized that none of the transactions are getting settled, or there is nothing which is getting positive confirmation, but the payment has been deducted by the customer, and we have been able to see the screenshot. So when the investigation took place and finding, it was found that the person had created a fake QR code and put the fake QR on the original QR stuck outside the shop. So that is how the fraud happened. Such frauds can be prevented by implementing digital signatures in the QR code. Most of you must have got the new PAN card. If you have not, if you apply, you will get a new PAN card with a special QR code reader, which will not be able to be read by any application. It requires a special QR code reader application from NSDL to read the contents of the QR. So such kind of systems, once implemented, they will reduce such incidents. NFC payment is your near frequency code payments based on the RFID principle. So there is an option nowadays which comes, like one of the bank where I am the customer, it allows us to even block the NFC auto payment of 2000, 5000 without PIN as well. So we prefer to then use such cards to reduce and minimize the risk. Mostly people do eavesdropping or try to get a device which is near the vicinity of the card and try to swipe off. The amount may be small, 2000 rupees, But if it's in volumes, if it is done, it becomes, you know, almost quite some handsome amount. So solution is, on the app, you should keep it off and not keep it on. Other aspects of this is where malicious applications are purported to be banking apps. You don't even know whether the actual app is a bank or some other entity. SIM swap based attacks are there, where SMS authentications are there. Luckily, Try has come with a mechanism where if there is a SIM card which gets lost or corrupt or fallen, and the new SIM card gets issued, for the first 24 hours, there is no OTP which is received on that number. So that helps in person identifying if something is serious or wrong. And then they try to prevent such attacks. Phishing attacks are specifically targeting the mobile device users. And most of the people get influenced blindly without applying logic. So that is another reason. Talk about Indian policy and regulators. We have RBI master directions on issuance and operation of prepaid instrument in India. We have the Ministry of Electronics and IT security rules. We have the Digital Payment Ecosystem Water Committee report. We have RBI circular IT system and security report of 2011. We have RBI cyber security framework, which came in 2016. There is RBI circular for consumer liable protection in on July 6. In this circular, very clearly it says if the password is shared, the or OTP is shared, the liabilities of the customer. But if those are not shared and there is something wrong with the bank, the entire amount bank has to compensate to the user. The same circular got released in January 19, where it was for prepaid instruments and wallets. Same contents are there. Only thing is, in the case of RBI circular consumer liability, it talks about NEFT, debit card, current account, saving account. Whereas in the PPI guidelines, it only talks about wallets. So what I will be the comments, and then we will I will answer those questions. So the idea is that there are various payment modes existingly available here, and we can try to be more in terms of you know, how to secure it. So do not share your passwords. OTP should not be shared. Have a separate bank mobile number for banking related purposes, separate number for your social media and other work, so you can distribute the risk. Have a backup of that number, alternate number, so that if something goes wrong, you can always use your services through the second number. That is how we it can be done. I think there is a question about what is, how do you make a complaint if there is something wrong. So basically, if something goes wrong, you need to do a police complaint. You can also do complaint online. There is a website called cybercrimes.gov.in, which is the Ministry of Home Affairs cybercrime website. You can report it online by putting all the relevant screenshots, your ID, photo ID. The complaint is then directed to the local police station where you reside, and then the particular police station will call you. If there is something urgent, you go to the nearest police station. In city of Bombay, there are 6 cyber police stations. Each zone has one, and the central cyber police station at BKC, which does investigation of fraud above 50 lakhs, and all the remaining 5 does the investigation of amount which is about 2 lakhs to 50 lakh rupees. And any amount which is less than 2 lakhs, the local police station does handle those kind of cases. So you can always go to the police station, do a complaint, and provide all the relevant information, and accordingly your investigation, once it is done properly, the money recovery are higher. People sometimes do not complain, saying that if you go to police, it is of no use, the money will get wasted, any which way there is no recovery. So I'll tell you, it is not the case. There are chances you get your money back. You have to be on time, real time, spontaneous, and also take actions faster, because that is how it will help you to recover your money or block the funds. Most of the officers are competent to do so. Don't have an impression that if you go to police station, they will not do their work. There are trained staff available to help you people. You can always get that investigated. Yes, legal system is slow. It takes 3-4 years in the court, but that is how the system is. You can't blame the system. The court works rely on a lot of paperwork and documentation, so you have to prove everything, and once you are able to establish and prove that, then probably the complaint can be entertained by them, and then investigation can be completed. So you can always try to do so. Also, I've seen at times where people, when they make payment, they do not read the instructions properly. So when you see UPI and other payment modes, it clearly says that if you want to, the message clearly displays that if you click on this, you authorize this, the amount will get deducted or the amount will get credited or debited. So people should read that. If you don't read and you just blindly accept and approve transactions, then you can't blame that, oh, I was looted. So that is another thing which one should take care or keep this in mind when it is about that. Plus, we've also seen a lot of fraud happening because of the documentation. So whenever you give a document, KYC document, people do not attest it properly. That is, you need to mention on the document, not on the white space, but on the document itself, that the document is given to so-and-so agency for so-and-so purpose on so-and-so date and time, so that that document cannot be misused from that agency. If it gets misused, and the liability will of the person from where that document got leaked. So it is always better to attest your documents and then submit, rather than I have seen people giving their Aadhaar card, PAN card, passport on WhatsApp to everybody and anyone, which is a very, very bad practice. People keep everything of the entire family members in the handy. If required, we can always share with somebody, but there is no need to share the original pictures or photos. Instead, you can take a photocopy, attest it, and keep it ready, and then take a photo of that document and then send it to the other side. The effort wide is, it may be time consuming, but this will ensure that your documents do not get misused, because these documents itself can be used to procure a SIM card or open a bank account. So better to always attest it. So these are the general ground rules of this. Any further questions, you can post on the YouTube chat or on the Zoho Q&A section, and I'll be happy to take answers. I don't see any questions being posted. We'll conclude the session in case if there are no questions there.
Any questions?
We have some 60, 65 people on YouTube and around 20 on Zoho. So around we have some 80, 85 participants live right now. 79 rather, a few who got dropped. Thanks, Kavita Mehta madam, for your feedback. But I'll be sending a link for you people to give the feedback which you need to give, so that you get certificates for attending this from the college. And if any questions, you can always post. The link is being shared on the chat on YouTube as well as on the Q&A for Zoho users. What USSD do? Sharma Shukla is asking. Okay, so USSD basically is when you have a feature phone, not a smartphone, like your Samsung Hero or Nokia or 1100, 3310 kind of phones, where you don't have internet, you don't have any extra smart features. with the help of USSD, you can check balance of your account, which is having the mobile number registered. You can even transact the amount up to 5,000 per day and 50,000 per year. So that is the basic amount which is allowed for people where there is internet connectivities are not there, but still the digital payment has to be made. So for those people, USSD can be used. What jobs students can procure in this field? So Vishal, thank you for this question. If you are wanting to contribute in the financial stability and so there are technical jobs, there are legal jobs, there are compliance jobs, there are fraud risk jobs. If I were to classify, there are some 10 domains in which you can get job, depending on what your like and interest is. If you are good at programming, you can become one of the good application developers. If you are good in auditing, you can do that as well. If you are good in compliance background, you can or audit, you can pursue that career. When I started, I was a technical person turned into legal, because most of the stuff gets stopped at legality in the court. So legal with technical knowledge becomes a very, very lethal combination, because you understand the technical side, you understand the legal side, you can bridge the gap. So I have acquired 6 academic degrees in that context. I'm not doing a marketing of myself, but I did BSc IT first, and then the last degree is law. So from IT to law, it was a journey. Depending on the way I worked in the domain, people could, the cases which I got to work on, I found legal to be the ultimate destination, because everything at the end of the day gets settled or decided in the court of law. So once you know the law of the land and the technical stuff, it is always better to present the cases for people who lose money or who are defrauded by fraudsters. So Vishal, to answer you, a lot of jobs available, but you will have to be very, very clear about what domain you want to choose, technical, non-technical, because that is how this particular thing would be working towards in the future. You need to have right kind of skills, and apart from your degree, diploma, you have to do international certifications, domestic certifications, or get the hands-on. I see a lot of people show interest to do internship, but then they only want the name of the company where they work. They don't really want to work. I also get a lot of applications with people for me to start to work interning and all. I don't mind getting people working on it, but the problem is that people are not serious. They just come because it's like fun. You get to learn a lot. You can also develop the skills. More practical experience exposure you will get, the more better you can become in this domain. So thanks Vishal for your question. Thanks Shama for your question. Anyone else who wants to? I think we'll wait for maybe 2-3 minutes more and then try to conclude. Kernel SP, very helpful. What jobs? Already answered this question. I think, ma'am, we can conclude if there are no questions. Vandana ma'am, Nupur, Nanda ma'am.
Yeah, sir. Sure, sir. Okay, so good evening, everyone. So I'm here, myself, Nanda Rupnar, to present the vote of thanks for today's webinar. I would like to thank our guest speaker, Advocate Mr. Vicky Shah, for enlightening us with his knowledge. Today's webinar was full of knowledge and interesting things, which gave deep insights into the topic and also revealed some interesting facts about digital payment safety. I'm pretty sure the knowledge that sir gave us will definitely help us in future. Thank you so much, sir. I would also like to thank our principal, Dr. B.B. Sharma, sir, for giving permission to organizing this session. I would also like to extend my gratitude to our degree college vice principal, Dr. Preeta Nilesh, junior college vice principal, C.A. Vidyajar Joshi, and also our college management. I would also like to thank our HOD, Ms. Purnima Bhangale, for her constant support and guidance. Last but not the least, I am thankful to participants, student volunteer, and organizing committee who really work hard to make this event successful. Also, thank you to all the students present here for paying attention and clearing your doubts. With this note, I would end my speech here. Thank you. Your feedback is valuable.